verse 18 concludes this point that all the nations have the opportunity to be heirs of Abraham. Now, this ties in again what we looked at last week. Remember we talked about who Abraham's real children are? They're the children of faith, aren't they? So we're going from defining who his real children are to now looking at who his heirs are as his children, and this will continue on through the end of the chapter. But the promise of the inheritance through Jesus Christ to all nations. But it leads to a very legitimate, obvious question. What then is the purpose of the law? And so, verse 19, what purpose then does the law serve? It was added because of transgressions until the seed should come to whom the promise was made. And it was appointed through angels by the hand of a mediator. Now, a mediator does not mediate for one only, but God is one. Is the law then against the promises of God? Certainly not. For if there had been a law given which could have given life, truly righteousness would have been by the law. But the Scripture has confined all under sin that the promise by faith in Jesus Christ might be given to those who believe. The purpose of the law. First, understand that the word law, Hebrew Torah, has a couple different contexts. We do read in the Bible that the law describes the first five books of the Old Testament: Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, and Deuteronomy. In fact, those five books are sometimes called the Law of Moses because Moses wrote each of those books. So in some contexts, you read about the law and the prophets. That's the idea, the first five books. But here, the context is more specific, namely the law given to Moses and thus the nation of Israel at Mount Sinai by God. That law. And that law has three basic parts, categories. We're studying on Wednesday night's Exodus. We're getting into a lot of this. One category you could call the ceremonial part of the law. This is with the priesthood, the Levites, the tabernacle worship, which later became the temple worship, and all those sacrifices and offerings. Now, we recognize today as Christians, looking back, we see that all those sacrifices and all that priesthood, that's all been done away in Jesus Christ. We don't see that connection to the present day. A second part of the law was what we could call their civil code. Remember, Israel was to be a theocracy. They weren't to have a king or a parliament or a congress or anything. They were to be governed by God himself through his law. So the civil part of the law was that section which explained to the Jews how they were going to deal with issues that would come up. For example, let's say a guy steals an ox or a sheep, and you catch him. And let's say you catch him red-handed, he's still got it on him, but let's say you catch him, he's already sold it or killed it. How are we going to deal with those situations? Is an ox going to be worth more than a sheep? And all those details are there in the law for them to govern themselves by. Important. That part of the law also is where Israel was to be distinct and different from other nations. And so you have the dietary restrictions in the law because they were to be different from other nations. But you see, again, all of that we recognize, that's not really relevant to us today. We're not Israel living under a theocracy. And this is, of course, where the Bible critic likes to try to get at us by quoting from one of the capital punishment requirements there in that part of the law, and says, see, you Christians believe that. No, we don't. Doesn't apply at all today. But what's the third category? Interestingly, this is the one that was actually given first, and that's what we could call the moral law in the sense of the Ten Commandments. And that applies not just to the Jews, but to all nations. This is God's moral standard as encapsulated in the Ten Commandments. It is here that Paul in Romans chapter 2 was talking about how the Gentiles, who don't actually have the law, because they're Gentiles, they haven't been given the law of Moses, but they show that the law is written on their hearts. Their conscience bears witness to it. And isn't it true that any society, any kingdom, any nation throughout any time of history, any organized group of people in any way, village or whatever, don't they have certain laws about people in the village just indiscriminately killing each other, committing adultery, stealing from each other, bearing false witness against each other? It's a common denominator in humanity, isn't it? It's because of the conscience that God's put on us. It's because of his moral law written on our hearts. And in addition, the parts of the Ten Commandments that speak about worshiping the Lord only and him only do you serve and don't committing idolatry, well, Romans chapter 1 deals with that issue, doesn't it? Where Paul makes the case that the Gentiles are without excuse because they ought to be able to look and say, well, there must be some great creator God. We don't know much about him, but that sun in the sky there, that moon up there, those stars up there, this river, that tree, that goat walking by, we know that's not God. And yet what did the pagans do? They worshiped the sun, the stars, the river, the goat. So they're without excuse because they should have known better. Now, that's the aspect of the moral law. And so back to verse 19. What purpose then does the law serve? It was added because of transgressions. Because of speaks to purpose. The purpose of it. See, the law, by God putting it in writing, shows a standard which we then recognize that we break. You see, the problem with the conscience can get hardened, can it, by sin? Hardened in the sense like calloused. Your hands get hardened, they get calloused. What happens? They're not as sensitive anymore. And you see, that's what sin does. It begins to callous our hearts, our conscience towards God's moral law. And again, Romans chapter 1 is a good place to look to see the consequences of what happens in that.